Let's keep seeking the Lord's face in all these matters and just watch what God does, all right? But in that, and with all that being said, Psalms 136 says, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever." And that is what God is. He is good. His mercy does endure for forever. We thank God for that. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, as we come to the throne, we thank you for the privilege and the honor and the opportunity. Lord, as we do seek thy face in all these matters, I pray thy will to be done in each and every one. But Lord, as we do come together in thy house with thy people, I ask you to help us, guide us, direct us, and lead us as we go forward. Lord, help our ministry of live stream. We're spreading it all around as far as we can reach. And I pray, Lord, you'll multiply that many times over. But we just rejoice knowing that you're doing it. But they keep trying to hinder us. And Lord, we know that you can work through that and above that and give us victory over it. And I pray that you will. And so we just praise you. Just be with us throughout the service tonight in Christ's name. Amen. Yeah. I'll share with you this morning. We try to get it from the Facebook link that we have and then put it on over on YouTube. And I hear tell it's kicked us off. And that happens. Apparently, boy, they don't like what I'm saying. They try to shut me up from time to time, but we will shut up. We will keep on preaching. Well, somehow, some way, we'll get it on there. And so for those of you tuning in at home, don't worry. Don't worry. This morning's message, we're going to get around. Brother John, he'll work all that out, and we'll get it on there. But hopefully before long, we'll be able to get some things working with our sound booth and all like that, Brother Tim, so that we can get this a better program. Amen. And it's not that we're trying to put on any show for anyone, because we're not. What we're trying to do is take God's word and reach as many people with it as we can. Amen. And as Brother John was sharing with you this morning, God's blessed us with a great outreach. And we want to continue to keep reaching out there as far as we can and touching lives. I didn't know, where did you say, South Africa? Is that where we're being watched in other countries? Is South Africa is one of the biggest places where we're picking up followers? Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And he said this morning, he said, "Julie, you go ahead and get back with your Filipino folks and let them know. Get on the internet for us." Amen. Share it out there. Share it out there. So if you're tuning in at home, hit that share button. Share it out there. Because we want to reach as many people as we can. Why? Because we hold the truth. We're going to broadcast it as far as we can and do as much with it as we are able to. Amen. So we thank God for that. Brother John, come on.
Good afternoon. I hope everybody got a good nap.
Amen.
I did. Unless I let me sleep for about 30 minutes. That's all right, too. But yes, be sure to share those and keep praying for us about that ministry, because we cannot keep on doing as much as we can to spread the word. You'd be surprised at the people I get telephone calls from during the week talking about how things mess up. I'm not mad about that. And I appreciate the telephone calls I get.
They're listening.
And so if they're watching, they're letting me know and they're keeping me on my toes. And that's what we want. So
amen.
Y'all keep praying for that. Blessed assurance. If you would, stand up and please pay for me.
Purchase of God for us.
y'all who've been missing out on that, be sure to come back there at church.
Yeah, yeah.
Have a little bit of get together back there. But there was some young ladies who were sitting back there and they was talking about, said, well, we want the choir to sing this song. And I said, wait a minute. Y'all sing that song, fire's on the brain. You know, we worked several months out here to put Brother Mike.
Amen.
And every once in a while, we gotta have a little bit of rest on our voices and a little bit of rest doing other stuff. So when we take those breaks, that's what gives y'all the time, y'all that sing, that don't wanna be in the choir, but if you've gotta lay something on your heart, you can get up and sing. That's what we're gonna do, so. Miss Doris, I think we got the okay from them, not this coming week, but next week. They're going to be singing for you. You're going to have a special that you probably, yeah, probably had never heard this lady sing before, maybe one of them. Right. So, y'all be sure to spread.
I'll keep working on them.
Spread that word.
Amen.
You know, God's good.
Amen.
And, you know, these new people that we have coming into church, we need to make them feel well.
Amen.
And we have a lot to learn from.
It's all going to be family.
One big family.
Does it matter if you can sing or not? I mean, what considers
brother?
Troy, what do you consider singing?
Well, check it out. You know, sometime I might
be. Well, that's a start. That's a start.
I just don't want to empty the building out.
Well, if you get up here and it gets too rough, too bad, or something other. If I know the song, I may jump in there with you. So they won't be thinking that you're so bad. It's like, man, he's doing pretty good. Richard, just shut up. See how that works? We'll make the most out of it.
Amen.
You know, one thing is, what John's trying to get across here is the fact is that it's all about fellowship, family, and brothers and sisters. God brought us here for a purpose and a reason. Amen. And we need each other more than what we realize we do. That leaning on one another and uplifting each other. And it's so important. Go ahead, Jeff.
But the best thing, the most thing that we need is a revival.
Amen.
Yes. Revival is again the thing 3-4 years.
Hit it and run. All right. got your big shindig coming back up and around and everything. That is 10 o'clock on the, yes, sir.
Well, kickoff, brother. Kickoff.
Kickoff.
For the overcomers.
Kickoff for the year for the overcomers. Now, he's got some things in the works. He asked me the other day, he said, Preacher, I said, yeah, I left it. It's developing. Amen. It's developing. But so much about that. We're looking forward to a great year with the overcomers this year. Kicking off on the 14th, 10 o'clock. Y'all be here, be a part of that, and I promise you, you'll be blessed in the process. Now, thoughts on the 20th, 6 o'clock at night. It's family night around here. That's when we're all going to come together and have us a movie night. 6 o'clock, in case you're wondering, that's a Friday night. Amen. And so we got us a movie night going that night, and we're going to need all those little bitty piggies and the blankets and the hot wings and all the other little stuff. Amen. How many of y'all like to eat stuff when you're watching movies? All the snack stuff. So we need all that little snack stuff and everything. So everybody brings some snack stuff. Who knows? Somebody has some hot dogs and chili that night. Who knows? You know, we just do all that sort of deal. But have a good time of fellowship on the 20th, kicking off at 6 o'clock. And I come to find out while I go that on the 21st, Eugene's got you a big shindig coming up called bowling. They're going to go bowling. They're going to meet here at
12:30.
So they'll meet here at the church at 12:30, and it's going to go until 1 to 3. 1 to 3 is the time frame they're bowling. And so Brother Tim's got all that scheduled and worked out, and that's the 21st. Be here at 12:30. Teenagers, all right? And then, of course, on the last Tuesday of the month, we're looking forward to going back over to the Bible Barn and putting Bibles together. We will meet here at 9 o'clock Tuesday morning. We'll make our way over there to the Bible Barn. He said, Preacher, how are we going to get over there? Well, we got vans. We got vans and we got drivers of vans. So don't worry, you just come on over here, be at the church, 9 o'clock Tuesday morning. We'll make our way over there and we'll put some scripture together. Amen. I remember the last time, Brother John, I think we had like 1,300, just shy of 1,400 Bibles that we put together. And I'm looking forward to kicking it off this year. What is it?
1,405. Oh, amen.
You remember it all? I slept since then, Miss Brenda. I'm glad you're on top of it. Praise the Lord. Amen. A lot to look forward, but that says a lot. Think about that. One Bible, how many lives can that touch?
Right.
The multitudes. So it's wonderful. You come on out last Tuesday of the month. Look forward to that. That's what we got now. Now, and of course, we're going to February, and you all know we got things in February, too. You say, Richard, why in the world we do all these things?
No.
Because we're family. Because we're body believers. Because of coming together and fellowshipping draws us closer together. We started our dinners on Sunday afternoon again, and so next Sunday we're going to have Mexican, I think is what we're looking forward to and everything. And in case you don't know what dinners are all about, basically what you do is you bring a dish around our theme, which next week will be Mexican. And what we do here, what everybody that comes, each family pitches in $5. And that goes for the meat for the next week. And Brother Alex, he takes that $5 and it multiplies. You might be amazed how much money we've already got saved up. And so he takes that, he buys the meat and everything so that we have plenty of meat. Brother Jeff, do you find there's plenty of food back here when we go eat?
Hey, you never run out. We
always have, seem to have enough with desserts and food and all like that. And the reason why we do it, let me explain it to you, church. If you're listening at home, this is why we do it. That's why you need to come and be here with us. The reason why we do it is for fellowship, getting closer together. If all you ever see is somebody on a Sunday morning and they're across the aisle over there, chances are you don't cross that aisle too much. You go over and say, hey, my name is so-and-so. I'm glad to have you. Glad to meet you. How's it going? And if it's then, if we don't know each other, it makes it difficult. Even though we might be under the same roof for many years. But when you have a dinner with people, week in and week out, when you're having time of communication and conversation, it allows for closeness to begin to build and to begin to grow and all like that. Let me explain it to you like this. I know Brother Tim. I spent time with Brother Tim. Brother Tim knows me, and I don't shy away from him. Matter of fact, my door as pastor is open to everybody. Amen.
Yeah.
And I don't mind having fellowship and communication with any of you. Matter of fact, I look forward to it in great anticipation. Jack, we know each other, brother. We've spent some time together. Amen. More than just showing up every once in a while. We know each other. The more we do that, Brother Jeff, the more we grow, and we are a family. We definitely are. So, Troy, you're learning this, brother. You're learning this. You're learning all about us. And it's much more than words. Anybody can do lip service. We're not about just saying a bunch of words. We're about backing up with our actions. And so that's so important for us to get out there and people to understand. And the more and more that they see that, and the more and more, June, that they participate, then they start seeing really the bond that God's already brought between us. Amen? And what a great church that we have. Yes, Brother Jeff.
I just want to thank you and Amy. One thing, Brother Troy, that they did when we started this, they would every week move to a different table, go to their own table, and the pastor over time, and make sure he was visiting with everybody. And spend that time with them.
What you do, if you come back here, just look where my glass is sitting down and find a spot at that table. Because I imagine Amy set my glass down, and that's where I'm supposed to go. That's what she does. She sets my glass down and says, you're bored up. So in case y'all wonder why I go to where I go, that's where my glass is at. Amen. But no, he's right. Jeff, right? Look, there's not, and I told him right on the front end of this thing. Let me explain something. Have y'all been to church for 20 plus years? I mean, y'all, 20 plus years been in church? In that 20 plus years, how many times have you been in those churches and seen clicks?
A lot.
Ain't gonna be no clicks here.
That's right.
Ain't gonna be no clicks here.
That's right.
Where we go one, we go all.
Yes.
Everybody. Everybody. So Troy, if you come in, you become part of things like that, and it seems like this is where God's leading you, ask Jeff, who came and he's been part of us now for a little over, how long you been here, Jeff?
9 months.
Right, I was thinking you'd get close to a year. So 9 months. How much are you a part of things, Jeff?
I've been adopted. You're going to have a birthday.
Did you get that? He came in, he got, and he's part of it. And it's more than just words. Because anybody can say anything. We're not here to tickle ears. We're not here to stroke egos.
Right.
But we're here to tell the truth, and we want to grow together as a family. Yes, ma'am, Ms. Dorsey.
I just want to thank God for you and your family, didn't you?
Yes.
Amen. Well, I appreciate that, Ms. Dorsey, and I thank God for you.
Pardon?
I thank God for you. Because I'm not as effective if you're not here. We feed off of each other. Mike, do we not?
Amen.
We were talking the other night. You know, he's number four, I'm number four. You're number four. Amen. And the thing is, but how God bonded us together means something. It's more than words. Anybody can say anything. It doesn't mean anything if it's not backed up with actions. That's Miss Wanda. She's here. She's my secretary, in case y'all ain't figured that out. But we spend time together. We know. And when she cries, I cry. When she laughs, I laugh. We have an effect on one another. That's why Brother Ed right now, him and Miss Kim, being down like they are, it's affecting everybody. That's why Miss Irene, you being here tonight, it affects me.
Amen.
Have y'all agreed with that?
Amen.
Amen? Amen? That's why it's so important for us to understand. And for those of you tuning in at home, church is what it is here. We're family. And that means everything. And so that's why we strive to push forward and do the things that we're doing. And I just can't tell it any straighter, any plainer than that. That's why we have things like the Overcomers. Matter of fact, it sounds like Brother Tom is bringing something to the table where, y'all hold on, we're about ready to have another outreach. What it is, he said, preacher, he said, you might want to look into, he said, a lot of people out there have a question. He said, you can Google to find out what the number one question that people are asking, and they're seeking out answers. He said you might be able to put together a little 3 to 5 minute video and answer those questions that the world has. And start a build off of our YouTube channel, Brother John. And he says what you can do is, where they're asking all these questions and you're coming up and you're giving them the answers, and just look how that's going to build and grow. Just with the 3 to 5 minute. He said you, Brother Bill, and Brother Glenn coming together, you can answer a lot of questions.
Yeah.
I have no doubt because I have the answer.
That's right.
Amen.
Right there. Didn't say I know it all, but I know that book has what we need.
Amen.
Right there. It makes all the difference. So y'all pray about that. Y'all pray for this church. And I tell you, the door is open. The door is open. It's more than words. Anybody, Aunt Jenny, can do lip service. It's those that live up to it. That makes all the difference in the world. Let's pray. Lord, as we bow before you, as we come to the throne, we're thankful for this opportunity to get ready to receive this offering. I pray that it be glorious and blessed to thee. But Lord, these words tonight, I pray that they will take root in hearts. These people that are seeking out and trying to find a home, I pray, Lord, if it be thy will, that you bring them to us. Bring us new families, both young and old alike. Lord, I pray that we'll see a great rejoicing, a great revival, but a great growth. I think about what Brother Tim shared with me this afternoon as he's concerned about new kids coming in. Not just for his age group, but he's thinking about Brother Mike and his age group. And I pray, Lord, that you will give more than Brother Mike could even imagine through those doors. And by doing so, more for Brother Tim than he can even imagine. Which in turn, we look across the auditorium, we be full, looking to have more room. Lord, thy will to be done. Use these things, utilize these things. In a day and an age where they say it can't be done, we know, Lord, you can. You said in Psalms there, except you build the house, we labor in vain. Lord, I don't want to labor in vain. I want you to build it. I want you to grow it. Thy will to be done in it. So we praise you. We glorify you. And Lord, most importantly, we're hoping to carry what you've given to us to a lost and dying world. And in that, I pray it will make the most impact that you will. And Lord, not us. You to be glorified, not us. We praise you. We say thank you. Christ's name. Amen. See the need of and everything. You say, well, preacher, how much is that going to cost us? That's why I'm glad y'all are sitting down. It's probably going to cost us in about $28,000. But we got the money, and the fact is, it's a great need. We've needed to upgrade our sound system in our platform for a long time, and I'm gonna bring it for the church here before long, and the only reason I have it, because we've got, there's some people I just don't wanna work into that. Y'all bear with me. I've been working into that on some other projects, so as quick as we get a little wind in ourselves and everything, we'll bring it before the church, but now you know. And so there it is. But we, so much that we wanna get done, and we're not gonna be frivolous. God told me a long time ago in his word that I'm to be a good steward of the things of God. And you ask these fellas around, they'll tell you, preacher ain't one for just spending money or throwing money at problems or things like that. Matter of fact, chances are, I'm not so quick to want to spend any dollars, but every now and then there's needs to spend dollars. And so in that we do. I'll give you an example. Y'all remember when we got our sign fixed about a week, a year or so ago? Y'all remember that? Well, they were wanting to take and sell us on those electronic signs out there where we have, the cameras in the signs and all like that. That was going to be about $27,000. That's all. It's $27,000. No, we backed off that. Y'all remember? We backed off that. I said, I cannot justify. Now, if somebody wants to dig deep in their pocket and say, hey, preacher, I got $27,000 lying around. I want to give that and fix the sign. You do that, we'll get the sign fixed that way. But here's the deal. I cannot, in good conscience, being a steward over God's dollars, go and justify that kind of expenditure when that's really not what we need. There's other things that we need more so. And so that's what we do. And so I just kind of give you a little insight. I give you a little bit a little mindset on a few things here tonight. All right? So now y'all know. John chapter number 10. Go back with me there tonight. I hope in the process, as you're hearing me talk and hearing us discuss these things, I hope that you understand that I don't do anything lightly, and the things that we do with great thought and prayer. Very much so. This is very important business God entrusted me with, and I don't take it lightly. As I said to you this morning, I looked out across the auditorium, Brother Glenn, and I see each and every one. Those are lives. They're important to me. Those are valuable to me. But not only to me, but to the Lord. He's entrusted. We need to understand our value and our importance here, you know. Now this morning I shared with you the purpose that God created us for, a purpose and a reason, and we thank God for that. And tonight we'll go on into the next step, Brother John, with number two, the passion. The passion that's behind that. Look with me in verse number 11. He said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. Now here's the deal. Ain't nobody took his life. He laid it down.
Right.
He gave himself for you and me. And that means something. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God so loves us, he gave himself to us so that you and I would have a way of escape. We thank God for that. What a great opportunity. John 15, verse number 13. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends if ye do whatsoever I command you. What Jesus is saying here is, I think of you so highly, I will give you my life for you. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard of my Father, I have been known unto you. That's why we have the Word of God. Verse 16, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it you. Why? Because he loves us. Because he loves us. He cares for us. He's given himself for us. If you think about how valuable and how important you are. Now think about that. Now we're using Brother Ed today because he is very dear to each and every one of us. And he is going through a difficult time right now. But as he lays there in that bed, I got news for you. God cares for him.
Amen.
It's not likely that God's thinking of him. On the contrary, he cares for him. And so when I go to God, I say, God, on the behalf of my brother Ed, I pray that not only will you heal him, but restore him so that he can move back around amongst us in fellowship with us as you would have him to do so. I love him too. And in the process, I want you to do something like that because you're the one that can.
That's right.
Does he care? You might have right, he cares. He done gave me his word, Miss Brenda, that he so loves me, he's given himself to me and for me, and because of that, I have what I have. So now that I have that, Ephesians chapter 5, go there with me. We see God's heart, God's passion, given us his son. Verse 1, be ye therefore followers of God as dear children. And walk in, what's that next little word right there?
Love.
The business of God and how we conduct the business of God is so crucial on how we are going to grow the work of God. Let's understand this. What did you say, Jeff, a while ago about when I came here? Let me ask you a question. Are you appreciative of me?
Amen.
Well, let me throw you something right back at you. I'm appreciative of you.
Amen.
I've done my part, but you've done your part too. And by the way, that little lady next to you, she does her part also. Have y'all ever seen what Julie does?
Yeah.
Huh? Y'all see what Julie does? She works people. She works her people. She can get areas and with people miss doors that you and I can't get with. Because they know her and they talk a different language than you and I, Brother Mike. That's all right. That's all right. But my sister can get in there and she cares for her people, and we've been seeing how she's brought her people here.
Amen.
Now that's important. That's important. Why? Because she loves them. Because she loves us. Because we love one another. And we're going to walk in that love. Walk in love, he says. As Christ also has loved us. And hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. Charlie, God gave himself to you. Now he's looking to you to give yourself to others. And when we learn how to give over that way, and when we learn how to take and not hold back in any way, wow, what God can do with that. The passion that Christ has for us, he lay it all on the line for you and I.
Amen.
We sing songs like he grew the tree that he knew would be. Amen. We sing songs, Brother John, about him laying his life down. If I was the only one, he would have done it for me.
Amen.
What a great God. What does that tell me? He so loves me. And because of that, Galatians 2:20, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I. But Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Do we live a life that is pleasing to God? Do we live a life that God can use and utilize? Do we live a life that cries out, that's a born-again believer? Is that the kind of life we live? Read on the next verse, verse 21. Look what he says. I do not frustrate the grace of God. For if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. He said, look, I'm not going to go back to man's ways. I don't frustrate the things of God. No, I'm not about man's things, Miss Claudia. I'm about God's things. I'm going to live for God. I'm going to do what God wants me to do. You know, when I think about all these questions people have, Brother John, thank God we have all these answers that we need to be given them. We're not here to complicate. We're not here to confuse. We're here to simplify and to enlighten. Thank God for that. Go to 1 John chapter 3. Now Christ laid down his life for me. Christ has given over to me. That's his heart. That's his passion. 1 John 3:11. For this is the message that ye heard from the beginning, that ye should love one another. You know, we'll do things, Brother Tim, for each other because we love one another. The other night, I was over there at the hospital to visit with Brother Vern and his dad, and of course, his mother-in-law and everything. And y'all know her mind is gone. She don't know half the things. Matter of fact, she don't even know Miss Debbie, her own daughter. She don't even know, but it doesn't matter. They still love her. They're still looking after her, caring for her and everything. And so I'm sitting there and we're going through and all, and I told him, I said, you know, y'all probably better get out of here because they only want two in the room. You know, two in the room. They said, no, preacher, you stay right here. You stay in here. So we fellowshiped a while. Well, some nurses started to come in. They brought me out, Brother Mike. Stayed in there. Had some good fellowship. Then we left. Or I left and went out over and saw Brother Ed. Lo and behold, if Brother Jeff didn't come walking through the door, Julie, check him out, walking through. Huh? Why? Why? Because we love one another, care one for another, we're willing to do one for another, amen? You see, that's what matters, Miss Doris. How we care for, loving one another, reaching out one to another. That's what God intends on his people to do.
Amen.
Doing what's needful and necessary to help one another. Isn't it good? You know, Miss Carol, I'm so thankful for Miss Kay. Miss Carol was having an episode. She was laying in her floor over there. Miss Kay comes along and she finds her. She sees her and she calls me up. She says, hey, preacher, Miss Carol's in the floor. I need you to help me get her up out of the floor. We go over there and get her up out of the floor and get her back in her chair. Well, later on that evening, she starts questioning or wondering about Miss Carol again. And we go over there. Lord, she's back in the floor again. We get her up this time, and I looked at Miss Kay, and I said, Miss Kay, there ain't no way, we're going to have to get her checked out. Something's going on here. Something ain't right with Miss Carol. Well, we get the ambulance over there, and they take Miss Carol on to the hospital, and when they get her, and they take her, he says, she's got a UTI, and she's dehydrated. Now, what if Miss Kay would not have cared about Miss Carol? What do you think would have happened to her? What?
Yeah.
See, any good that Miss Kay cares for Miss Carol? Amen. And then we got acting upon that, and we begin to see the effects of that. And now today, Miss Carol is back with us in church. Amen. Right there.
Amen.
They come to find out because of that. Look, it's important for us as body believers to love one another, to care one for another. It shows our passion and where our hearts are. Read on. So look, we're here to love one another. Not as Cain, who was of that wicked one and slew his brother, and wherefore slew he him? Because his own works were evil and his brother's righteous? Marvel not, my brother, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death to life, because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. We're not about death. We're about life. We're going to embrace the life that God's given to us. Why? Because we're going to love one another. We're going to care one for another. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. You know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him. If you're about death, you're not about life. Verse 16. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. We ought to lay down our life for the brethren. That means we got to learn how to give one to another. Helping one another, caring one for another, amen. Hey, it makes a big difference. It shows the life that God's given to us. 1 Peter chapter 2, go there with me. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21 says, for even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow his steps. Who did no sin, neither was God found in his mouth. No God in his mouth. If Christ so loves me, and he does, and he's given me that love, and he has, and now that I possess that love, and I do, should I not share that love with all those I come in contact with? It ought to affect me. You see, his passion should be my passion. His passion should be my passion.
Amen.
His purpose should be my purpose. Why? Because, Brother Tim, it reveals the life that I possess is valuable to me.
Amen.
Valuable to me. Read on. There's the next thing I want to see here tonight. Verse number 10. Look at it with me. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. We know what the enemy's about. We know what his objective is. Drop down with me, verse number 12. But he that is a hireling and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, seeth the wolf, coming and leaveth the sheep and fleeth. And the wolf catcheth them and scattereth the sheep. The hireling fleeth because he is a hireling and careth not for the sheep. One of the things that's very important here, and for us to understand, I heard a guy tell me years ago, Brother Mike, skin in the game. I said, what do you mean skin in the game? He says, when you got skin in the game, means you're invested into it. We need to have some skin in the game. Here's the deal. This church right here means something to me. The body of believers, I sit up here this morning, and I kid you not, I'm looking out across the landscape, and I see each and every one, and it looked pretty good in here this morning. Amen?
Amen.
Sure enough, all the different ones we had in here, and I can count several others that were out because of sickness and all like that. And by the way, we got three others with us tonight that were with, or four, excuse me, four others with us tonight that were with us this morning.
Amen.
Amen. But I sit here, and I look, and I see one over here, and this, and over, and that, and that, and I'm counting them all out, Brother Jeff. I'm taking it all in, and as she's playing over there on the piano and everything, it hit me right between the eyes how good God has been to us.
Amen.
How great He is, and in the process of this, it ought not be taken by chance. We ought not lightly think of this. God's allowed us the opportunity. How many of y'all remember 2 years ago? Have y'all remember when they said, hey, you need to step back and isolate and shut off yourself one from another. How many of y'all remember all that? I do. I remember, Brother Jeff, when you came up back there in the parking lot. I remember how terrified you were and worried about these things because we didn't really have a handle on certain things. And I told you then, we're going to follow the Lord. We're going to trust God in this thing. And if you want to be here, the doors will be open for you. We're not shutting anything. We're not isolating. We're not shutting away from each and every one. And why? We need each other.
Amen.
We need each other. And more we see this, the more and more we understand this, the more and more we understand that God's given us a great opportunity. And Faith Baptist Church means a lot to me. I got skin in the game. I can't just all of a sudden throw in the towel and say, hey, I quit. I'm done. No. Hey, I got skin in the game. It means something to me. And when I see the Lord Jesus Christ and He talks about how He's passionate about what He's given to me and how He's blessed me and all like that, He's got skin in the game. You think God cares? You think Christ cares? You know He does. And when we take up that mantle, we follow in His steps. I'm here to tell you, when you start investing in the things of God, get a part of the things of God, you'll start caring about it too.
Amen.
Let me ask you this question. What would y'all think over the next 2 weeks I just decided to stay home? What would y'all think? Huh? How much would y'all appreciate me for that? Huh? I'm just going to stay home. Would that be okay? Go ahead, y'all. Speak freely. Go ahead. Well, would y'all like that?
No.
Y'all know I can't. Y'all know I can't. Well, preacher, you've been trying to tell me, boy, preacher, you need to go on vacation. I can't, Brother John. I got skin in the game. It means something to me. I remember Miss Nancy Powers one day, and she had open heart surgery, talking to the doctor. She said, this ain't going to keep me out of church, is it, preacher, or a doctor? He said, Miss Powers, you're having open heart surgery. She said, it ain't going to keep me out of church, is it? Miss Nancy's kind of, she is kind of stuck. She said, look, my preacher all the time talks about, we don't call him, we crawl him. Word gets back to me. She ain't even the one that told me about it. Word gets back to me. He said, boy, if people know that, they must be crazy. Huh? They won't miss church for nothing. Well, you won't if you've got skin in the game.
Amen.
If you're invested in it, if it means something to you. Amen. It's valuable. It's important. You see, Jesus values us. That's why He's passionate about His people. And if we pick up that mantle, Jim, we'll be passionate about the people of God too. Think about that. Then that light. Then that plight. You know, here's the deal. Look with me, verse 13 again. The hireling fleeth, because he is a hireling and careth not for the sheep. Matthew 7, verse 15. Matthew 7, verse 15. Beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. You shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Look at what they produce. Look what they are. Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. Just take a look at what they're producing. Look what they're producing and you'll know. I think about football. We're right now dab smack into the football season. Oh, mercy. The NFL, oh, the Super Bowl right around the corner. And every now and then I see these guys go across the line and go. Now, it's an amazing thing. I saw a meme the other day, and somebody posted this meme and says, and just like that, prayer was back in the NFL.
Yeah.
Yes.
Where was prayer at a month ago?
Amen.
It ought to be there at all times. Amen.
Yes.
There.
Yes.
Now, let's not get discouraged this evening, but just because somebody goes doesn't make them a believer. Doesn't make them a believer. By their fruits, you should know them. I hear people all the time talk about Jesus, but at the same time, they're talking as nasty as the rest of the world. It's awful hard to believe. Read on. Verse 21, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you, depart from ye, ye that work iniquity. You never know you. You play games, you put on the front. 1 John chapter 2, verse 28. Little children. It is the last time, and as ye have heard, that Antichrist shall come. Even now are there many Antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last time. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. Verse 20. But ye have an unction from the Holy One, and ye know all things. By their fruits ye shall know them. There's a lot of people that have come through our doors. They even picked up a hymn book singing, oh, how they love Jesus. They praised him with their lips, but their heart is far from him. Our plight is the fact that we have all sorts of different people that come through our doors, and we're juggling to see which are and which aren't. Well, it's simple, brothers and sisters. Just let the Word of God be the guide and the director of what we do and what we don't do. And in the process, it will all iron itself out, Miss Brenda, where it needs to be. I see it all the time, Brother Mike, but I just leave it to the hands of the Lord and let God do what God does. So what does it do? It reveals who is and who ain't. How they speak about life. How they treasure life. Remember Simon the sorcerer? For the sake of time tonight, I'm going to give you the overview. Acts chapter number 8, verse number 9 through verse number 13. Here he is. He's going right along with them. He's witnessing. He's seeing all this. As in other words, he's right there at a great service time. A time of service, Brother Glenn, and all of a sudden, testimonies are breaking out. Lives are being changed. I mean, different ones are going up. Hey, one will raise his hand over and say, hey, preacher, I just accepted the Lord. Another one down here says, you know, preacher, I just gave my life over to the Lord, and my children, they got saved. And another one breaks over and says, hey, preacher, you know, we're going to go to the mission field and serve God. And revival's breaking. see in this. He says, hey, I want to be some of this. I want to be just like all the rest of them, but only in appearance. Only in appearance. And so he learned how to sing whole, how he loves Jesus. He learned how to carry that Bible under the ark. He learned how to take that walk and those steps and put on a show just like everybody else. And then Brother Peter comes down there. And Brother Peter, he lays his hands on them and the moving of the Holy Spirit of God and this, that, go great. And he's like, whoa, I want me some of that. Let me give you some money so I can give me some of that. Peter says, you're in the gall of bitterness. Your money perishes with you. You thought that the gifts of God could be purchased with money. You're not right with God. He told him, he said, you need to repent. And his words were, well, why don't you pray to God for me? As in other words, saying, why don't you go repent for me? Don't work like that. Don't work like that. And nowhere in the scriptures where you will ever read where Simon the sorcerer ever got it right. Nowhere. I've studied it. I've searched it. I've never come across any scripture that ever said he got it right. But I did read 1 John chapter 2, verse number 19. They went out from us because they were not a part of us. There's been a lot of people come in here learning the tunes that we sing, trying to talk the talk for a period of time, and out the door they go running because there are none here of the Lord's.
Amen.
Now understand this. That is our plight. There are those amongst us that are not part of us. That is our plight. Not everybody that says, Lord, Lord. That is our plight. We're having to deal with, we're having to wade through. But here's the deal. Remember, this is about cherishing life, loving life. When we start to understand the purpose of why we have life, when we start to see the passion that Christ has given to us and how we are to share that with others, that helps us better with our plight and the situation in which we find ourselves. How we deal. Let me explain it to you like this. How many of y'all have read in the Bible where the goodness of the Lord leadeth to repentance? I'm not asking you to hold back. They may not be part of us. They may not know the truth that you and I don't. But don't ever hold back because there may be a chance that the goodness of God leads
Amen.
To the repentance.
Amen.
That's how we have it. That's how we do it. Because ultimately, like God said, he's not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. I ain't willing that any should perish either. So we're going to do everything we can, Ms. Doris, to win as many as we can. That is the plight in which we find ourselves. I understand the fearless times. I understand the deceitful men. I understand all of that. But I also understand, number four, go there with me, verse 14 and 15. Look what he says. I am the good shepherd, and know my sheep, and have known the mine. As the Father knoweth me, even so know I the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Drop down, verse 17. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, that I might take it again. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. You know, one of the things that's very amazing about the business of God, Brother Tim, in the secular world, if you don't show up for work tomorrow, you can get fired. In the spiritual world, if you don't show up at church Wednesday night, I'm not asking you out.
Amen.
Matter of fact, if all of y'all decide you're not going to come in next Sunday, I'll be here. And you'll probably have to tune in online because you're not going to hear me any other way. But I'll be here. You say, what do you mean, preacher? You have the opportunity to give of yourself or not give of yourself. That is your choice. You have the power to make that decision. The way it says, I have power to lay my life down, and I have power to take it back up again. That's my choice. I have that power. Read it again. Maybe overlooked it. Therefore, if my Father loved me, because I lay down my life, that I might take it again. Verse 18. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. You know what God doesn't do? God doesn't restrain any of us here to do anything for him. He asked, and we did. Freely, freely. You know the wonderful thing about life? When I look out across the landscape, I see a lot of problems about control. You do understand that a lot of the things that they do today is about control. It's funny. They use terms like, this is for your safety, this is for your well-being, we want to protect you and keep you safe. Okay? Y'all with me? Now, we can have a debate tonight about whether or not seatbelts actually save lives or not. I can give you an argument on both sides of that. I can talk to those that would say, I was in a car going down the road and we were having a head-on collision or a T-bone or any of that, and lo and behold, my seatbelt caught and kept me out of the windshield. I've got people's testimonies on that. But then I know others that would give you a story like this, that they were going down the road and how God used that to throw them out of that car. And if they'd been in that car, they would have gotten crushed in that car and they would not be here today. Matter of fact, I am a result of a person that has stemmed from somebody that was in a car accident, that if he would have been in that car at the time of that, he would have been crushed, and I wouldn't be here. But yet they tell you, seatbelts save lives. Now I get it. Anybody can mess with numbers. I get it. Okay? I get it. But if it's about saving lives, why did they put a dollar sign to it?
That's right.
Oh, that's not the only thing they do. Now, I get the fact that a lot of people don't do a lot of things that's probably what we would call safe. But I don't know about y'all. I grew up in a time when my mother, who had five sons, would carry us as a child in her arms when we went down the highway. And yet, all five of us are still here.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to argue one way or the other. Don't misunderstand me. But we've implemented all these things in the name of safety, protection, and yet we kill millions of babies every year.
Right.
Doesn't make sense to me.
Right.
If we truly value life, we value it in its most precious, simplest form as a baby. But we don't. If we truly value life, we would value it in its old, very much down the road kind of state where their health conditions are very critical. And we wouldn't be trying to euthanize them.
Amen.
Y'all know that goes on. There's a push to say they've reached, they've already had their value. They're not valuable anymore. What happened to the choice? Look what he says here. He says, I got power to lay it down, and I got power to take it back up. If we value life like we say we do, we'll utilize that power for his honor and his glory. Look what he says. He's given us a choice. You know what God never does? He never restores, restrains us to accept him or not. Freely and freely. That's what God does. Amen. Now we know the outcome is naughty. If they won't accept Christ, hell is what they're facing. But he tells them. But they have the choice.
Amen.
They have the choice. Power that is in this, the power. So guess what? You've got a choice. Matthew 28, verse 18. Jesus came to speak unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Got all power. Make all decisions. Right here. It's all on the Lord. Verse 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things which I command you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. Amen. You know what that means? That means, Brother Glenn, you've got a choice. Right. Now, you might regret not doing it later, but you've got a choice. You either go and tell or not. Does God stand over you with a lightning bolt every time you don't witness on his behalf and shove that down your throat? Does God take a whipping stick and beat you with it whenever you go, don't go and testify on his behalf? No. He allows you the opportunity. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every preacher. Now, here's the deal. Some just bring to take God up on his choice. And they do. And others, Brother Tim, do not. But he leaves it to us. He leaves it to us. Just like Christ said to us, he has the power to lay his life down. And he has power to take it back up again.
Amen.
He's got that choice. Aren't you glad that God gives you that choice?
Amen.
Just the way God designed it. Power. And then number five. The fifth thing about life. Look with me, verse number 16. Another sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd. Drop down with me, verse number 19. There was a division, therefore, among the Jews of these saying, and many of them said that he hath a devil, and he is mad. Why hear ye him? And others said, these are not the words of him that hath the devil. Can a devil open the eyes of the blind? Now, when I start thinking about life and valuing life and the appreciation of life and everything, I hear the conversation of the crowd. Then again, decisions that's got to be made. You hear some people say, it's my right. It's my right. I can choose to do this and I can choose to do that. Well, I guess you can. Or in our society, I guess you can. But you better be willing to live with that choice.
Amen.
Amen. Let me explain it to you like this. You have a choice tonight to go out and get drunk or not. You can go down to the bar and you can take and liquor up as much as you want to. I'm looking at a whole crowd, except for you. You're not over 21. You do it, it's illegal. Now, that don't mean that the rest in this room here tonight can't go and do it and it becomes illegal. You say, how does it become illegal? When they leave that building,
amen.
They get in that vehicle, and other lives are at stake. Y'all with me? Amen. So we have groups of people that chit-chat back and forth. I believe this, and others say, no, I believe that. And they argue back and forth. You know, right? The pack. Not everybody sees life the same way. Not everybody views it the same way. Now here they are, attacking Christ, calling him the devil. I kind of laugh at that one because he's God in the flesh. But that's all right, because I've also had people look at me and call me the devil. So I guess that puts me in good company.
Amen.
Amen. So I'm all right with that. But that pack mentality, how people look at it, the groups come together. No, we're this way. No, we're that way. That's why here at Faith Baptist Church, Brother Tim, that's why we don't hesitate to let people know what we believe and why we believe what we believe and stand upon that.
Amen.
It affects people. It really does. It's kind of like this, brothers and sisters. How many of y'all know what a pantry is? What's wrong with the rest of you? Aren't y'all farm people? The pantry, the old pantry. Go get that out of the old pantry. I knew you did. Sure enough. You probably got one there at the house, don't you? The old pantry, go in the pantry and get it out.
No.
Miss Doris.
I can't get my washer
dry. All right, Well, that's a pantry then. We'll take it. We'll take it. Amen. And that blew my mind. I'm going to get my mind back on where it needs to be. Thank you, Ms. Norris. Thank you, sister. Sure. I know. I know. Now I'm trying to think about where I was going with the pantry story. My illustration, I had a good illustration of pantry, you just got both come out of the water right there.
I'm sorry.
It's all right. Well,
Lord help
me. Yeah, amen. Lord help me. God help me all the way through this thing. Brothers and sisters, the fact of the matter is there's opinions on every front. This one thinks that and that thinks this and so on and so forth. And unfortunately, yeah, I know where I was going with the pantry deal. Thank you, Lord. We're living in a day and an age where they say take labels off of things. They say get rid of and dispose of and all like that. So I challenge you tonight, if that's what people think, if that's what direction they want to go, you go home tonight, you take your razor blade or pocket knife, and you've got every label off of every can.
Yeah.
You've got your pantry, yeah, and leave it at that. Then when you get ready to go and make supper, you go on in there and you play the guessing game.
Yeah, right.
And then you tell me after you've got it all fixed and cooked and everything what you're going to have for supper. Because you won't be able to tell me on the front end because you won't know what's in the can.
Yeah, that's right.
The reason why I don't have a problem with us labeling some things, identifying with some things, mm-hmm, I don't mind letting you know I'm for life.
Amen.
Not only life, but having it more abundantly. I don't mind telling you that I'm not about killing. I'm not about to steal, kill, and destroy stuff. No, I'm on the other side, life and more abundantly. Y'all get what I'm saying? I have a problem being on that side. And I don't care, Brother Charlie, if they want to associate me there, because I can be one of those Jesus freaks and be okay with that because I am.
Amen.
Amen. Amen? Right? I don't mind. I don't mind. But we're living in a day and an age where they, and they want to muddle all that up. And they want to, you know, they want to monkey with that, Brother John, and say, no, we don't want to label these things. But yet, you got LBGTQRSB and the other one's Z. Amen.
Yeah.
Whatever they all after. Amen, right?
Yeah.
Transgender, transhumanism, trans this, trans that. You know the only trans that I like? It's called my transmission inside my truck. Amen. And the only reason I like that, because it gets me from here to the house. That other stuff, it won't get you across the street.
Amen.
So we need to look at what we're talking about. And I have no problem. Look, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I'm not ashamed. I'm glad to be a part of that. So I'm glad that I'm a part of the family of God. When we talk about we're family here, we understand what that means. We understand what group we are. We understand what we believe and why we believe what we believe. Because we've nailed it down. That means something. And we go forward in that. So the life that we have, the life that we possess, this is what we do. And because of that, God's glorified in that. He's glorified in that. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 13. Now for the recompense in the same, I speak as unto children, be ye also enlarged, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion hath light with darkness, and what concord hath Christ with Belial? Guys, look, there's some divisions that we ought to make. Get in the right group. Be with the right people. Read on. What agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them, and will walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them, be separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the clean thing, and I will receive you and will be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. I'm glad I'm a part of the family of God.
Amen.
I have no problem separating from. I have no problem being a part of. I don't mind them, Miss Linda, labeling me a Bible thumper. It's good. It's good. And I'll be a part of that. Because it brings me to number 6. Look with me in verse number 27. My sheep, that's me. Is that you?
Amen.
This is our part. Y'all with me? Hang on to this one. We're going to wrap this thing up. We're going to enjoy this. Hang on to this one. My sheep hear my voice. And I know them, and they follow me. Ain't no mystery. I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I committed unto him against that day. I know Jesus Christ, and he knows me. And I give unto them, what's this next one right here? Tell me how much God's about life.
Yes, perfect.
Tell me how much God is about life. Eternal life, never-ending life. A life that will continue to keep going on and on and on. Eternal life. He says, and they shall never perish.
Amen.
Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand.
Yes.
My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Full circle. Full circle. Let me wrap this up real quick. I know it's getting late. Full circle. Genesis 2, 7. God formed man from the dust of the ground. Made him. Worked it out. Made him. Every little internal organ, every little detail, every brain cell, made man from the dust of the ground. Every bit. Then he did this. Breathed into the nostrils of man, and the Bible says he became a living soul. Alright? Y'all with me? Now, does God care about life? I tell you how much. He created it, he's given it to us, and now, not only did he give it to us, he has made it eternally.
Amen.
He's not about death.
Right.
He conquered death and hell. So when I see my brother Ed lying there in that bed, y'all get this. Told you this is the good part. When I come in there and I see brother Ed's laying there in that bed, and I see him right there, I said, God, heal my brother. Restore my brother. I don't like to see him like this. Guess what? You don't either. You say, well, why would he be in that condition? Why would he be in that circumstance? Go back to the beginning. God says, don't eat of the fruit. Because in the day you eat of the fruit, you're going to do what? Die. Now here's the deal. This old flesh is fit for destruction. Why? Because that old devil's tainted it.
Amen.
He's tainted it. He's here to steal, kill, and destroy. But the Lord's about life and more abundant. So when we see this right here, we have one up. Here's our ace in the hole. We go to the Lord and say, God, I see my brother's laying there in that bed, and I know you don't like that. I don't like that. Show your hand in the mighty way. I know what got him there. I know what got me here. But because your love, your mercy, your grace, your power, your love for life, I know you can take what this is and bless it, glorify it, and show the world that you're all about life.
Amen.
And then I stand back and I watch what begins to happen. Come in on a Wednesday after praying on a Tuesday. And not only is my brother still alive, he's joking and cutting up. And his wife says, he's been awful feisty today. I said, I asked you a question, Kim. Would you want him to be any other way? That shows my brother's got to fight. And he's fighting for life. And that encourages me. And I come back on Wednesday night and I begin to testify and share with the church that my brother Ed is fighting for life. And I get excited about that. And I ask y'all to join me and let's pray for brother Ed so that he will fight for more life. And I come back on Friday. Holy hope, would you imagine? He's doing even better on Friday.
Amen.
Now I'm saying, Lord, don't just keep his life alive. But restore him. Give him that abundant life. Because they don't expect him to get out of that bed. Well, I stopped listening to them.
Amen.
I don't really care what they have to say anymore.
Amen.
You go talk to a doctor or a nurse, it doesn't matter. I'm going to talk to him.
Amen.
Because until he has the final say, Ed's still with us.
Amen.
He's still moving. And I'm asking God to restore him. That's why we should be people that embrace life, not death. I see too many people right now. I get it. Turn your news on. You hear about this new variant that's coming. Old China. Let me ask y'all a question real quick before we go over in prayer tonight. How many of y'all remember 2 years ago when they were showing all the propaganda, and it was propaganda they were showing you on your TV screen? You were seeing videos coming out of China where people were walking down the street and all of a sudden going, and you saw black goo coming out of their mouth. How many of y'all remember seeing the video of the black goo coming out of their mouth? Y'all remember that? And our people seeing that, they were watching this whole preacher. What kind of thing is coming to America from China? Oh, it looks horrific. It's bad. Now, how many of y'all know anybody had COVID? Me too. You know I never had the black goo? I'm a little let down. I'm a little disappointed. I was looking for black goo, Brother Mike, and I ain't seen it yet. I ain't seen it the first time. The other day they said in one day in China, 30 million people died in China. It's a lie. They want you thinking about death. They want your eyes focused on death. They want you to see all the devastation and all the horrific things. Why? That affects your mind. God wants you to think about life. More abundant. There's the difference. I choose life. I show you death. Show you life. God says pray for life. That's what I'm going to do. Y'all at home, I'm going to look for life. Not all this death. When we look to life, brothers and sisters, you know what that does? That inspires others to rise up, and they too will start looking for life. Y'all see it on your TV screen. Y'all know what I'm talking about. 30 million people died in China in one day. At the same time, they're lifting the travel restrictions out of China. Huh. Are we listening? I think they want us living in fear.
Yes, sir.
God said his people perish for lack of knowledge. God said he's about life. He's about more abundant. Now, I'm going to end with this. I know we went over tonight. I would have been good for you.
Amen.
Listen to me. My life consists because of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I will not leave this earth one day shorter or stay here one day longer than God wants me to.
Amen.
I'm going to let you in on a little secret. I told y'all this. Y'all think I'm crazy. That's all right. I probably am. Crazy for the Lord. But when I leave this earth, I'm meeting him in the air.
Amen.
In case y'all haven't figured it out, that's called rapture.
Yep.
When I leave this earth, I'm meeting him in the air. And by the way, I had COVID too. Remember. But I'm going to embrace the life that God's given to me. What about you? And by the way, that life is what? Eternal. Let's pray. Lord, I pray that you speak to the hearts here tonight. Bring us to our knees. Thy will be done in Christ's name. Amen. All stand with page, Brother John. And I'm sorry I went over tonight. Y'all bear with me tonight. What page, Brother John? 270. God's holy heart, you come. Come on right now. Come on right now. Sustain this life as long as I can, Brother Glenn, because I'm going to be here until he calls me home. Amen. Sure enough. Appreciate y'all being here tonight. Thank God for the opportunity. Brother Alex, good to see you, brother. Good to see you. Y'all pray for him. He's in the back with them young folks. Y'all saw that last Sunday night and everything. Does a lot. We appreciate it. Brother Alex, dismiss us in prayer tonight.
Father, we come to you and we just praise and thank you for all that you do for us. As we look around and we see how your hand moves and works and how you're taking care of Brother Ed and Father, everybody that we've got on the prayer request. We thank you for those that you've touched in their healing from surgeries and getting better every day, Father. And we do pray for life, Father. And we just thank you for the messages that we've heard today. And we just ask you to continue to bless this church and our church family, Father. And make us good workers for you as we go out and tell the gospel and spread the good news, Father. If there's any here that don't know you as their personal Savior and have a personal relationship with you, we ask that they step forward, Father, and that just give us the words and help them and just let you save them and start your relationship with them. Father, bring us back at the next appointed time and we give you all the praise and glory. For these things we ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.